Hi, I'm Marge Easley, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 102-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. And today, we have Juan Carlos Gonzalez, candidate for Metro Council, District Number 4. Hi, Juan Carlos. Nice to see you.
Hey, it's wonderful to see you, and thank you for having me on.
You're very welcome. So tell us about yourself, why you're running for re-election to the Metro Council, and a little bit about yourself, please.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm born and raised in the community. I've spent my entire life in Washington County, aside from the time that I went to university on the East Coast. For my professional career, I've worked with communities. I've worked on poverty relief, on eliminating structural disparities, and really focusing on creating a prosperous Oregon for everyone. That's what I believe in, and that's why I'm running for re-election. These last 4 years, I've had the pleasure of supporting and representing District 4 constituents at Metro, our regional government. And for a second term, I'm looking to continue building on that work, recognizing that there's still a lot of important work to do, and continuing to build on all of the things that I've been able to learn in my first term.
There are some critics to Metro who say that it is a level of government that they don't quite understand. And as a Metro councilor, could you tell us the value added that Metro provides?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a question that I hear a lot in my district. What does Metro do, or how does Metro impact my life? And I'm always enjoy diving into conversations and helping people uncover the value that Metro brings to Metro residents and to Oregon and the Pacific Northwest in general, really. And to put it really briefly, what I would say is that Metro elevates issues of regional significance. There are some issues in our state, and especially here in our region, that don't start or end at a city boundary or a county boundary, and there are issues that really require our very smart people across the region for us to pool our brains, to pull our resources, to bring that strategic leadership to the table and to really comprehensively assess an issue. A really great example of that is over the last few years, the Metro voters approved an affordable housing bond, and we're in the process of working with cities and counties across the region to deliver thousands of affordable housing units in a new regional way in which people are talking to each other and coordinating on a whole bunch of different goals on that. Another really great example is the Supportive Housing Services measure, which was successful in May of 2020. And what we've been able to achieve with that is creating a comprehensive regional homeless services program that, like I said, works with the three counties, Multnomah, Clackamas, and Washington County, and specifically beginning to build a housing continuum services pipeline that helps people ultimately achieve stability and helps people get off the streets or get into a home and build their life from there.
Thank you. I'm going to focus a little bit now on another important issue that Metro deals with, and that's transportation. And Metro last year came out with a study on different types of congestion pricing and the potential effectiveness in Greater Portland. And many voters are concerned about right now is that it seems that tolling is going to be a feature of our lives in the coming years. It's not a popular decision. So can you tell us how you're going to sell this to Metro residents?
Yeah, another really important topic. And it's been something that we've been grappling with at the Metro level. And to be honest, this is an issue that a lot of major cities throughout the United States are beginning to grapple with. The truth is that the way that we funded transportation for, the last few decades, especially the last 40 to 50 years, we've had a gas tax mechanism. And the truth is that the gas tax just hasn't been able to keep up with basic maintenance and the kind of improvements that we need to make across the system. One, because of, a good thing that we've achieved is fuel efficiency in vehicles, therefore using less gasoline, and also the fact that prices on the construction side and on the planning side just continue to grow. So what you see is a graph that basically isn't adding up in terms of supply and demand for transportation. Actually, the federal government recently created this new designation for regional mobility pricing, which can be interpreted in many ways. Congestion pricing is one of them. There's still a lot of different demand management tools that are out there in which we can use to build infrastructure and support infrastructure in Greater Portland. I think the truth is that it's not a matter of if, but a matter of when. It's something that I know I'm looking at really closely, mostly wanting to ensure that families that are already struggling and are already living on the edge aren't pushed past that point, aren't being displaced from this program. What that means is creating low-income exemption programs from the beginning, making sure that the program is balanced in a way that allows for working families to make ends meet and to build a thriving family and to be a part of a thriving community, while also recognizing that 21st century infrastructure is something that we really need to invest in this region. And in general, Oregon has struggled to invest in and advance comprehensive and really the kind of projects necessary for this next century of economic growth. We already see that nearly all of the major projects that we're working on right now with ODOT in Region 1 in the Greater Portland area will have some kind of pricing aspect to it. And I think it's just a reality of what we need to work with and like I said, make sure it works for families.
Okay. Just one other issue that is pertinent to transportation, and that is safety issues. And in 2018, there was a regional transportation safety strategy that was developed, but the bond measure that was to help pay for it in 2020 failed to pass. In the meantime, there is an average of 23,000 traffic crashes resulting in injury per year. What steps should Metro take right now to make city streets safer for both drivers and pedestrians?
Absolutely. Well, this is one of the areas that I've really tried to lead on in my first 4 years, and I think we've made some really important progress. For voters in my district, I think one of the areas that you'll see immediate progress on is TV Highway, in which we've been able to work with ODOT on making immediate improvements. But we're also doing right now, we just launched this earlier in April of 2022, launching a new committee planning process to completely revision corridors like TV Highway, which is one of the key urban arterials that serve Washington County. There's many like it across the region, but in my district in particular, I think that's an excellent example of a road that you've kind of had the city grow up around it, and it's just not meeting the needs of community, whether that's lighting, whether that's safer crossings, whether that's better transit, whether it's better signal lighting at intersections and intersection design, all of those things. Washington County is rapidly urbanizing, and it's an issue that is alive and well in my district, and an issue that I've worked really hard to secure additional funds in to help us plan for a new future. And at the end of the day, like I said, we're having a hard time meeting the needs of these new transportation systems because of declining revenues and rising costs, and we're needing to kind of recalibrate that with new funding mechanisms. Like you mentioned, the 2020 measure was not successful, but we learned a lot from that. And one of the things that we learned is that there's a significant demand for these kind of improvements. And what we're doing as Metro officials is going back and figuring out how do we pay for this in a way that's equitable and that's fair.
Okay. Well, to wrap up, we haven't dealt with most of the other things that Metro does, but I wanted you to say what other concerns you might have for the metro area, what plans you particularly are concerned about, and also why should voters choose you as opposed to your opponent?
Yeah, of course. There are many issues that have come across the docket for us at Metro. Affordable housing continues to be an issue that we're working very, very aggressively on, both in terms of helping to build more affordable housing across all communities and across all neighborhoods, but also making sure that we're building housing of all types, including homeownership opportunities for families, and making sure that this region is an affordable place, a place where people can connect to green spaces, can connect to recreation, and all the things that make our region special. Part of that is focusing on a really positive economic recovery strategy, in which we're doing so diligently with Greater Portland, Inc., and many of the other economic development organizations throughout the state of Oregon. Another very important thing is, like I said, investing in our infrastructure for the future, addressing climate change. And I think a very real issue that we haven't had the opportunity to talk about today is addressing the humanitarian crisis on our streets in Portland, but also throughout all three counties, making sure that every person in Greater Portland has a place to sleep in at night, making sure that people have safe and stable shelter and are able to recover from the circumstances that they're in, and achieving functional zero, and making sure that families don't have to experience the kind of homelessness that we've seen throughout the last decade. The reason that folks should vote for me is because throughout these last 4 years, I have a record that shows that I am able to work on these things and deliver on these important topics. Again, my name is Juan Carlos Gonzalez, and I am the Metro Councilor for District 4 that has shown up and has been present, and I would love nothing more than to continue serving this district and serving the future of our state.
Thank you so much, Juan Carlos, for being with us today. Thanks a lot. And voters, please don't forget to visit vote411.org for complete candidate and ballot measure information. Thank you.